entrusted it to his dear ones, to my beloved ones. I give you the law. I entrust them to you. I put them in your hands. You are my most precious people, and I give them to you. This is the law of God. Hallelujah. They saw heaven that day. It said that there was fire in the right hand of God, and out of the right hand of God, out of that fire came the law. That's the hand that inscribed on the stone. There was fire in his hand. Oh my. Oh my. The law of God, it was fire that came from the hand of God. I don't know. Sometimes when we think about heaven, we are far too, as my dad says frequently, we are far too human or carnal when we think about heaven. And therefore, when we think about God and the things of God and the ways of God upon the earth, he said, I revealed myself to my children Israel. I gave them my laws. The whole world did not know who God was. They didn't have the law of God. It's written in Psalms somewhere. Psalms down there. It says that he revealed his word to Jacob, his laws and his decrees to Israel. This was on the mountain. He has done this for no other nation. God did this for no other nation. For they do not know his laws. But we know God. We know God. You know, all too often we think of heaven in a far too natural, carnal way, in a real small way. And I think Pastor Phil said it real good during our conference. Our heavens are really small, you know. You know, Scripture does say that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. And what we get out of that is you got to die to go to heaven. And that's not really what it's saying, you know. You know that's not really what it's saying. When it says flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, it doesn't mean you have to die to get there. If so, why are we even bothering living this life? Take my plate, I'm done. That's not really what it's saying. It's saying the carnal way we think and believe and understand and see God, in that place you really can't enter into heaven. You can't have an understanding of it. You cannot be enlightened by it and strengthened by it and saved by it. It's not your path of life. We live our path of life is made of dirt and clay when it could be sapphire stones. Because we don't know. We don't know. Oh. And I don't know, you know, listen, everybody has their own belief system. I am not foolish enough to believe that everybody in this house believes exactly the same thing. You know that, right? We all don't believe exactly the same thing. God's big enough to handle that. We're not. We're not big enough to handle that. You don't believe like me, I think you're going to hell because you don't believe what I believe. Okay, 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 okay. You're whatever, lots of names and ugly words that we use because you don't believe what I believe. Listen, we all don't believe exactly the same thing. It's in God's hands. Okay? And God, we all are at different points in life, and there are certain things that God allows us to believe to get us through some things. You ever experienced stuff like that? God ever let you believe in something? I remember when we were believing for a simple illustration. We were believing for a church, and this was back almost 30 years ago. And we were renting a church building, okay? And we believed that was our church with all our hearts, but we needed to believe that. We needed to believe that that was our church building. And we prayed for it and we trusted it, and even when it was time to leave, we fought for it, but we needed that. And then when we left it, we left that building, we believed we were going back. Like, that's ours! But it kept us going. It gave us hope. It gave us faith. Listen, that building ain't ours. It's never going to be ours. I remember years later, I called that man back and said, are you ready to set a building? Because I still believed it was ours. He said, no. He had a piece of the land next to it. I said, okay, I'll buy the land next to it. He said, okay, fine. This is what he said. He said, $10 million. I said, okay, we're done talking. I think that's when God started to redirect us. That's really not it. Yeah, somebody wasn't singing something. But God, amen, brother. That's the truth. But God will allow you to believe in certain things to get you through certain things. It's okay. Some of us need to believe in certain things in regard to the afterlife because it comforts us. We need to know and believe these things. And I don't want to shatter any of your hopes and dreams. But God will take you in your own strength and in your own way. But heaven is not as physical as you think it is. It's not as carnal and as natural as you think it is. And I think all of us are past the beliefs and understandings that it's actually going to be a mansion for every individual. Maybe some of you aren't. If not, I pray that you get your mansion. But I used to believe that every one of us had our own mansion, and I would think the silliness of it. But why are we all living by ourselves? I don't know. And you know, you understand, right? God takes us all in different ways. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. But Moses did see something spectacular. He saw that heaven was not a geographical location. It's not up there somewhere. The reason why we say it's up is because it's an ascended place. It's a place where God is highly exalted. Where is God highly exalted? He's highly exalted in my heart. The kingdom of heaven is within you, everybody. That's exactly the truth. The kingdom of heaven is within you. And even later on in the book of John, John quotes Moses so often. John, in the book of Revelation, where we think it's the end of the world, and it's not, it's a revelation of Jesus Christ. In the book of Revelation, John says that he saw those who overcame the beast and that they sang the song of Moses. Remember, we sang the song of Moses last week. We weren't real happy with it. Do you remember the song of Moses? The song of Moses is, you guys are going to fail. You guys are going to leave the land. You're going to go with the, remember the song? Come on, come on. Somebody get this song. Trick, get this song going. Come on. You're going to go into captivity. Bah, bah, bah. That's the song of Moses. And John says they sang the song of Moses. Why? Because the song of Moses is what enabled them to overcome the beast. Who's the beast, everybody? You are the beast. Man without God, I am a beast, a brute beast, when I don't have God in my thoughts and in my belief system. But the hard times, the struggles, the fire that you go through and the waters that you go through is what delivers you from the beast. It delivers you from yourself. It kills you from your self-life, from your pride, from your arrogance, from your blindness and ignorance. Amen? You need the fire. You need the song of Moses. Yeah, God will bring us through these things. And you know, heaven, it's not as physical as you think it is. You know, the throne of God. Where do you think the throne is? You want to give me that simple thing again, Robert? Where's the throne of God? Yeah, thanks, brother. I mean, he sits upon the throne of your heart. Oh, I know, but he's really out there on the throne. Okay. You see, heaven was opened up to them. Where was heaven? Heaven was all around them. Heaven's all around you. Where is heaven? It's invisible, everybody. Has anyone ever told you that God is invisible? It's not that he's far away from us. He's just invisible. Where is he? He's right here, or if you can bear to hear it, he's inside of you. Where is heaven? Inside of you. You know, in the book of Hebrews where it says that Jesus, he was the sacrifice, the lamb that was slain, and then he took that blood and he passed through the true heavens. What do you think the true heavens are that he went through? Me, I'm the true heavens that had the sin in it that needed the blood of Jesus to purge me and cleanse me. You think there's sin up there? No. Revelation, there's sin in here. There's sin in here. I need the blood of the lamb to pass through these heavens and cleanse these heavens, and purge and purify these heavens, and then God comes and sits and dwells, right? See, where is heaven? Heaven is just invisible. God opened up heaven to Moses that day. He opened it up to Moses and the elders. They saw God. In Ezekiel, the book of Ezekiel, remember he was in captivity, and it says as he was sitting by the river, he was just sitting by the river. He wasn't sitting by the Jordan River. He was sitting by a Babylonian river. He was in captivity. Remember the song of Moses, right? He was in Babylonian captivity. They sang it to him, and he was there. And as he's by this river that he sang about for the last how many hundreds of years, he says, I saw visions of heaven. And what was open to him was heaven. He saw the throne of God. And he said the throne was like a sapphire stone. And you remember he saw the four living creatures? You remember that? No? Some of you? He saw the four living creatures. He saw heaven itself. He saw visions. Where? In his Babylonian captivity. Where is heaven? It's all around you. I don't care what hell you're in. I don't care where you think you find yourself. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Sometimes I'm where I don't want to be, and I'm so happy, unhappy about where I am. But in the instant, God transports me from this place into heaven. In an instant, you are transported into heaven. And what happens? Everything changes. All of a sudden, I'm sinless and victorious and strong. What did I do? I just left one realm and entered into another realm. I entered into heaven. You see, earth is not really a place, this carnal realm is not really a place that you can fix. It's only a place that you can leave. It's only a place you can leave. You think you can fix all the problems that are in your life? Really, all you can do is leave them. And enter into a place called heaven. Have you ever experienced that? Have you ever felt the lowest of low and dirty and failed? But in a moment, God's transported you into heaven, and all of a sudden, you felt like you were actually, you know, a child of God, chosen, called by God. I have felt that so many times in my life. So many times in my life, I went from feeling like nothing to feeling like, wow, I'm the chosen one. And if you've never felt that, I pray you feel that. I pray that you will see visions of God and you will see the throne of heaven and you will know that you are his precious people. He chose you and he gives you what? He gives you his law. The laws of heaven. It's a gift to you. They really define you. The laws of heaven define you. Don't throw them away. They define you. They tell you that you're clean and holy and incorruptible. This is what Moses saw. This is what Moses saw. And on and on and on, everybody. On and on and on. Heaven is a realm that can be entered into. You ever read about heaven in Revelation? In the book of Revelation, not Revelations. Revelation. It's singular, everybody, singular. In the book of Revelation, it says that there are 12 gates to heaven. 12. Oh, there's only one way. I know that. Each gate is a pearl. There's only one way. Jesus, I know. Okay. But there is different access points into heaven. God can work in your way and my way. He can get you into heaven through many different things and many different ways. He can get you into heaven through your hells and your torments, through your sorrow, through your humility, through your joys, through your laughter. He can get you there all kinds of ways. And it says that heaven, the gates are open all the time. And it says that people are coming in and going out of heaven all the time. Why? Because I see heaven upon a cloud. And when I get past the pearly gates, like I can go in and out. No, because heaven is a real place for me right now. And I walk in. I don't know about you. I do. But I walk in and out of heaven all day, every day, and so do you. And sometimes you need to hear that, and then it defines the experiences that you have in life. I was sitting outside of heaven's gates this morning and this afternoon. I think it was even through the process of this man asking for God from me that it caused me to walk back through the gate of heaven. And all of a sudden, I entered into the realm of heaven, and I felt God, and I saw God. I saw visions of heaven, man. And God will use all different kinds of things in your life, and you will walk in and out of heaven all the days of your life. Is there someone who's experienced that can give me an amen? One person. That's right. Who's outside of heaven? Revelation tells you who's outside of heaven. The liars and the whoremongers and the fearful. Who's that? Sometimes it's me. Sometimes it's Ken. Sometimes I'm the fearful, unbelieving one. We're outside the gates of heaven. Come on, you experience this. This is your life. It's your life. And then I hear a word from God. I don't know. I experience God some way, and it pulls the fear out of my life. You ever have fear pulled out of your life or doubt pulled out of your life? And voila, you just walk through the gates of heaven. You all of a sudden, you're a believer again. This is what Revelation talks about. I don't know what physical thing you have in your head, and that's between you and God. I want you to experience something here and now, though. I want you to know that Moses and the elders, they saw heaven. They received the throne. They brought it down. This is the glory of heaven right here. We missed it in Exodus. Hopefully we'll catch it in Deuteronomy. What is this law? It's the path of life, everybody. It was what was underneath the feet of God. It is the path of life. And by the mercies of heaven, we will walk this, and we will be as the children of Israel of old. We will do everything that is written in your law. Amen. Let's end off with number 5, okay? We'll close with this. 5 says, it was an instant it was an instance of special kindness he had for them. What is this fiery law? It says in these first few verses, it says that he loved his people. That's why he gave it to them. He gave it to them because he loved them. And therefore, though it was a fiery law, yet it is said to go for them, that he was for them, and that it was a favor to them. The law of God, as we said, what's wrong is that we don't take the law of God and apply it to flesh and blood. We keep it on that stone. It really needs a fleshly heart to come alive. The law of God is written upon our hearts. You see, the law of God that's read from a stone cannot produce life. You know, you cannot read it. You cannot read it from a stone, if you will, and letters off a page. It can only become alive and active and powerful when it's from your heart. You got to live this from your heart. You don't say, I forgive you because God wants me to forgive you, but I'll never forget. That's a stony law. It's got no power. It's got no life. It's got nothing. I love you, but I don't like you. It's that kind of foolish thinking. It's a law of God that's on your heart that says, although you are the dirtiest, rotten scoundrel in the world, I don't know, I can't help but love you. That is the power of God that has worked in your life. That is the word of the Lord come alive in flesh and blood. It's the law of heaven, everybody. Amen? Amen. All right, everybody. The law is a blessing, not a curse. Why don't you stand up and praise God, and Pastor Dad, if you'll come forward.
I just don't have time. It's on? You're hearing me? Okay. I don't know how to comment on that. I've been scribbling. I can't write fast enough as the Spirit is revealing what Pastor Mike is teaching. I like the part. Hello? Sounds like it's going. Of the clarity. When we see the law, thank you. It reminded me of, I think I've spoken this one before, years ago when we first started coming down here and we were heading back home to the north and we're on the main road and it said, resume safe speed. What was that? What was the safe speed? So the law is not something against us. The law is something to help us understand and protect us. Because I'm not going to speed and kill myself and do the things I shouldn't be doing. So it's saying, watch yourself. But the other thing on the mountain, it reminded me of they sat and ate with God. But with that, they saw clearly. If you go back to the Emmaus disciples, Jesus walked with them. He entered their home. He sat down with them. He broke bread. And when he broke bread, they saw him. They knew him. So the thing is, God has something more for us to see, but we need to see through the law what it is in. It's protection. It's guidance. It's direction. It's counsel. It's not death, evil, and something to restrain you, but to direct you. And that's what I saw in all of that, Pastor Mike. And they saw clearly, no impediment in seeing. The law is not meant for that. The law was good. And why do we always see all kinds of wrong things? Well, I can't do this, and I can't. Protect yourself. Don't do this. Don't do that. And you'll have a long, wealthy, prosperous, glorious, happy life. Can someone say amen to that? Well, they saw clearly. That's what I saw out of that. I hope I got it right, Pastor Mike, because you had so much there, and I can't possibly speak at all. You did. Father, just give you praise and glory as you continue to help us see, my Lord. Yes, see beyond restrictions and warnings and forebodings. And Lord, it's not that at all. It was all given in love to protect, help, guide, direct, and give us, Father, an abundance of secure life. We give you praise and glory, and we pray always, Lord, may you open our eyes to see, our hearts to receive, and our minds to be changed, that we might walk a more powerful walk with you. We ask it in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen.